In this video, we're going to talk about patterns of inheritance when more than one gene is involved. We're going to be looking at dihybrid crosses. So how do patterns of inheritance change when we're looking at two different traits at the same time? Well, those are the types of questions that Gregor Mendel started asking next, and he did this by performing a specific type of genetic cross known as a dihybrid cross. A dihybrid cross is the mating of parental varieties differing in two characteristics. For this dihybrid cross, Gregor Mendel crossed a true breeding plant that had round and yellow seeds, both dominant traits, with a true breeding plant that had wrinkled and green seeds, two recessive traits. So, just a brief introduction to the symbols we're using in this particular problem. Capital R is the dominant allele for round seeds, whereas little r is the recessive allele for wrinkled seeds. Capital Y is the dominant allele for yellow seeds. And little y is the recessive allele for green seeds. Now keep in mind that each parent plant will have two alleles for each gene, so two R alleles and two Y alleles. Also notice that since these individuals are true breeding, they will be homozygous for both genes. Homozygous for the R gene, homozygous for the Y gene. And that's true for both the parent who's round and yellow, who's homozygous dominant for both traits, and for the parent who has wrinkled and green seeds, who's homozygous recessive for both traits. Now what we saw in this genetic cross is that all of the F1 individuals had round and yellow seeds. And this sort of makes sense if we just figure that we're taking a true breeding dominant plant for two different traits, crossing it to a true breeding recessive plant for two different traits. Another thing to keep in mind is that because of Gregor Mendel's law of segregation, the first parent was true breeding for round and yellow seeds. They can produce one type of gamete, a gamete that has a capital R allele and the capital Y allele. Keep in mind that each gamete will have one allele for each gene. The parent who was recessive for both traits, little r, little r, little y, little y, they also can make one type of gamete, little r, little y. And so the F1 generation is going to be the result of these two gametes fusing, and so the F1 generation will be heterozygous for both genes. Now, one convention to keep in mind, since this problem established that the R gene is listed before the Y gene, we are going to keep that order consistent throughout the rest of the problem. So the genotype of the F1 generation, capital R, little r, capital Y, little y. This supersedes the rule about capital letters going before lowercase letters. All of the alleles for R will be listed first, all of the alleles for Y will be listed second. Now, the real question is, well, what about the F2 generation? Well, there were two possibilities, two hypotheses. It could be that capital alleles will always travel together, and lowercase alleles will always travel together. We'd call that dependent assortment. Or it could be that you could get a variety of combinations. You could have capital R and little y, or capital R and capital Y. The same way, just because you got little y, it doesn't guarantee that you're also going to get little r. You might be able to get capital R as well. We would call this independent assortment. So why would this be different? What would this look like? Well, let's look at these two possible options. Now again, the case of dependent assortment. Dependent assortment suggests that certain alleles will always be found together in gametes. So meaning, if you got a capital R, you would know for certain that you're also getting a capital Y. That's a different allele for a different gene. But if they assort into gametes dependently, every time you get a capital R, you get a capital Y. So again, for example, every gamete that has a copy of the dominant allele for the seed shape gene would also have the dominant allele for the seed color gene. How does this compare with independent assortment? Well, independent assortment suggests that alleles for genes assort into gametes without relation to the alleles of another gene. If this is true, we would expect to see gametes of all possible combinations. In roughly equal frequencies. So what that means is you could get capital R and capital Y, but just as likely you could get capital R, little y. Little r, capital Y, little r, little y. Independent assortment says all four of these would show up in equal amounts, or about one quarter of the gametes would fall into each of these four categories. So what would this look like? Well, if we have strict dependent assortment, and capital R and capital Y are always together, little r, little y are always together. When the F2 generation, we'd expect 3/4 of the offspring to be round and yellow, and 1/4 to be wrinkled and green. Again, that would be the result we would see in a monohybrid cross if we're looking at just one trait, but with dependent assortment, we should see that in a dihybrid cross as well. Conversely, if independent assortment occurred, we would expect that there would be more options. We'd expect that there would be round and yellow seeds, but also some wrinkled and yellow seeds, and round and green seeds. Those are combinations that we hadn't seen in previous generations. We would also expect that the wrinkled and green seeds would show up at the lowest frequency. We see that's the case with dependent assortment as well, but with independent assortment, we would expect only 1/16 of the offspring to be wrinkled and green, whereas we expect 1/4 of the offspring to be wrinkled and green with dependent assortment. So, which of these two resulted? Well, when Gregor Mendel performed these experiments, he would consistently find that green and round seeds and yellow and wrinkled seeds, combinations of traits that weren't seen in either parent, those would show up in the offspring, and in fact, they would be more common than the wrinkled and green result, which one of the parents actually had. More than half of the offspring, 9/16, would be round and yellow, being dominant for both traits. But then there would be this 3/16, which would be green and round, so dominant for one trait but recessive for the other. Another 3/16, which would be wrinkled and yellow. And only 1/16, which would be recessive for both traits. So because of his observations, because of what he saw in his experiments, Gregor Mendel came up with his law of independent assortment. This says that each pair of alleles segregates independently from the other pairs during gamete formation. This means that just because one specific allele is inherited from a parent, that doesn't mean that a specific allele of another gene will necessarily be inherited in that same gamete. Just as we did with the law of segregation, we can use the law of independent assortment to predict which types of gametes a parent can make based on their genotype. So if a parent is homozygous dominant for both the A and the B gene, really they can only make one type of gamete. Recall that each gamete will have one allele for each gene. And in this case, all the gametes will have a capital A allele and a capital B allele, because those are the only options that that parent has. When we look at this next parent, who's dominant for the A gene, but heterozygous for the B gene, well, now there are two options. Half of the gametes will be capital A, capital B, and half of the gametes will be capital A, lowercase b. And what the law of independent assortment tells us is that when a parent is heterozygous for two genes, the A gene and the B gene, independent assortment tells us that every possible combination of gametes that follow the rules of having one A allele and one B allele, every possible combination will be present. Capital A, capital B, capital A, lowercase b, lowercase a, capital B, lowercase a, lowercase b. And we would expect 25% of each. We can now use this information to set up a Punnett square, and we'll look at examples of Punnett squares for a dihybrid cross in the next video.